So I will discuss HCV micro elimination. These are my disclosures. And of course, I will not go into the details since Holle remind you this elimination plan of the WHO. And we know and we heard that regarding the macro elimination, it will be probably very difficult for most of the countries. Nevertheless, the intervention and targets are very well defined. We have very few discuss the prevention of new infection for HCV. And of course, harm reduction is one of the most important policy to develop to reduce the infection and reinfection, of course, in the patients who inject drugs. And so you know that a lot of countries, including the first economy country, like United States of America, did not develop a very well program of harm reduction with syringe and needle exchange program, for example. And there is an epidemic of both overdoses and acute hepatitis C. The second tool is, of course, to improve the diagnosis. And you can see that at the global level, there is really a huge need for this diagnosis. And finally, the access to the treatment is a key issue. And we know that probably less than 10% of the infected population worldwide had access to the treatment. And we know, of course, that the treatment usually results in a complete virologic cure. So this is a situation regarding the cascade of care with a lot of infected population and, of course, a decrease if we look at the proportion of cured patients. I think that all the figures which are presented, of course, including my figures, are erroneous figures because there is a dynamic of the screening and access to care which is very difficult to overcome. So if we consider the limitation to HCV elimination, screening, access to care, and of course, especially for developing countries, the cost of drugs, but five among six treated patients are treated with generic drugs. So I will discuss the microelimination mainly by discussing three different populations. First one, the highly motivated and easy to diagnose population. In the middle, those patients with infection, but who are either unaware or undiagnosed. And finally, the very difficult to treat population. Again, the rate are approximative rate. And I will consider, following the presentation of Antonio Graxi last year, that probably the addition of microelimination will help in macro elimination. So microelimination is a treatment of well-defined population. And so, of course, there are a lot of population. Just as an example, decompensated cirrhosis. We heard with Stéphane some challenges and issues regarding this population and the use, for example, of protease inhibitors. The US veterans and also patients of different expert healthcare unit, for example, nephrology, hematology, oncology. And I will discuss some of this real situation. The first one is the microelimination in easy to screen population. You know that the Veterans Administration made a very big effort for screening and treatment of infected veterans. And so over time, we have seen a huge number of treated and cured patients. And in last August, it was considered that more than 100,000 veterans has been cured. And it was considered that around 25,000 veterans remain to treat. So in this situation of prioritization of the treatment in a very well-characterized population, you can see that around 20% of the diagnosed population 5 years about after the availability of DAAs had no access to the treatment. Another example is this example from the French Hepater cohort. We have included around 14,500 HIV-infected patients in 32 highly motivated centers, and it's a prospective enrollment, and those patients are followed for 10 years without any decision of treatment or no treatment. It's completely according to the physician decision. And so you have there the first message regarding the number of untreated patients. So, of course, good news, there is a significant decrease in the number of untreated patients. Nevertheless, 10% of the overall population remain untreated. And it is noteworthy that there is no major difference in the profile of the treated and untreated patients. And you can see on the right side of the slide that around 25% of those untreated patients are patients with significant fibrosis or cirrhosis. So clearly, despite, again, very expert center, very well identified patients, there is still a need for access to the treatment. This is another example, again, from the Hepater cohort. It has been presented at the last American meeting, and it deals with decompensated cirrhosis. So as you can see, we have around 1,000 patients included in this cohort with decompensated cirrhosis. And this presentation aimed to evidence the benefit associated with SVR. So significant reduction in mortality, a significant reduction in the cumulative incidence of events in patients who have been treated by DAAs. And we know that most of them, 86%, achieved SVR. So clearly, there is a benefit associated with the treatment. Nevertheless, again, it was this autumn, 18% of this priority population had not been treated by DAAs despite the benefit. So the summary for this easy-to-diagnose patient is, of course, there is a will. Of course, we have now the authorization to treat any HIV-infected patients. Nevertheless, and since 2 years of universal treatment, we did not achieve microelimination in those very well-diagnosed populations. So, of course, if we consider the population who has been undiagnosed or high-risk population, the situation is, of course, worse. So this population are multiple populations, but we can discuss the situation of prisoners, easy-to-treat patients, easy-to-diagnose. The migrants are, of course, more difficult to diagnose and frequently difficult to allow an access to care. PWID are also easy to diagnose, at least those patients with opioid substitution, since they are coming in the centers. And finally, HIV co-infected patients, and mainly men who have sex with men, are also easy to treat, since usually they have a regular medical follow-up with the infectious disease doctors. And nevertheless, in those populations, again, it's not a perfect situation for microelimination. This is an example in France for the prisoners. As you can see, there is a tenfold increase in the prevalence of HIV infection as compared to the general population. Half of them have detectable viremia, and nevertheless, less than 50%, and probably we are more around 10% even if there are some proactive programs now which are under progress, less than 10% who achieved SVR. The situation is also very difficult in the migrant population for several reasons, but of course it's a population with a high rate of infection and a low rate of access to the treatment. And of course it's very important to consider the treatment in those high-risk patients because they are the high transmitters, and we know now from prospective and retrospective data, especially in HIV co-infected MSM, that by treating any acute hepatitis, you have a 50% reduction of infection or reinfection in the community over the next 12 to 18 months. So clearly a need for an early diagnosis and treatment in order to reduce this risk of reinfection. And this is true, of course, with intravenous drug users, prisoners, and HIV-co-infected MSM. And we know that it will be possible to achieve complete elimination in those populations only by a systematic screening, access to care, and follow-up of the patients given the risk of reinfection and retreatment, early treatment of the reinfection. I show you this slide because it's real-life data regarding the cure of HIV co-infected population. So this is the French EPA-VIH ANRS cohort, only a cohort of co-infected HIV and HCV patients. So these are, of course, old results, but at that time, despite 2 years of priority treatment, it was only around half of the population, close to 60% of those HIV-HCV co-infected patients who achieved HCV cure. And we know that today it's probably around 85%, but it's not 100%. So we have to consider the screening, of course. We have to consider the access to care. And we have also to consider behavior change, which is not so easy to introduce. I mean modification regarding chemsex and so on, in order to be able to achieve the WHO goal. Finally, another population, the psychiatric patients. Again, it's patients where the diagnosis is easy. Figures are mainly corresponding to inpatients, so they are there, and usually they are there for weeks or months in the psychiatric structures. You can see that whatever the geographical area, there is a very significant high level of prevalence of HIV infection. It's around tenfold by comparison with the general population, and the access to care is very limited. So if we want to be efficient for micro-elimination, we have to convince, of course, our colleagues in psychiatry, in nephrology, in oncology, to make the screening and to allow a very rapid access to care. But just as an example, at least in France, the reimbursement of the drugs is dependent on the pharmacy of the psychiatric hospital. So for example, the biggest hospital in Paris is Sainte-Anne. The level of funds for the pharmacy is 700,000 euros. So of course, if we consider 20 treatments for HIV-infected patients, it will be impossible to pay for the psychotrope drugs. And so we have really to push the payers to reconsider the path of reimbursement. So finally, for the difficult to identify patients, it's of course very difficult. You already seen this slide with Ole. So we have really performed centralized care of those patients, easy to treat or high-risk patients who were referred to the hospital. And clearly, if we want to succeed in the screening and treatment of difficult to test patients, we have to decentralize the treatment. So, of course, to recommend a point of care or rapid diagnosis for test and treat policies in different clinics, sexual health in prisons, of course, in needle and syringe program services. But it's not so easy to perform. So just as a first conclusion, HIV elimination is clearly feasible since tools are available. Microelimination is a public health challenge which needs education of the patient, but also education of the healthcare providers, including doctors. And clearly there are some issues regarding the place of screening and access to care, whatever the medical situation, for example, in oncology or rheumatology. And I will finish on this two last slides, indicating that the barriers to antiviral therapy concern both patients and doctors. And in this American study, it was evident that some barriers were related to a priori of the doctors, and we need to overcome these a priori. And so we have to fight against fake news. Just as an example, the increased risk of hepatocellular carcinoma in DA-treated patients. We know that if we perform a simple univariate retrospective comparison, of course, there is an increased risk of hepatocellular carcinoma because these studies have been performed in countries where the prioritization was reserved to severe patients. So we all know as hepatologists that severe patients are at the highest risk of occurrence of hepatocellular carcinoma. But as soon as you introduce weighting, and so you remove the heterogeneities between treated and untreated patients, it's possible to evidence that there is a benefit with a reduction of the risk of hepatocellular carcinoma. And also, as you can see here in our hepatic cohort, a very early benefit regarding a decrease of the mortality. And it's noteworthy that it's hepatic mortality as well as extra-hepatic mortality. So the message for those patients or doctors who are reluctant for the treatment, whatever the severity of the patient and liver or extrahepatic severity of the patient, is that we have the evidence now, the retrospective as well as the prospective evidence, that the HCV cure associated with DAAs result in an improvement of hepatic and extra-hepatic endpoints. So there is no any concern about a risk and, of course, a benefit for all the patients. And just to finish regarding, again, this possibility to achieve macro-elimination by addition of micro-elimination, we heard from all that in a lot of countries it will be very difficult. And it's not only developing countries, but if we do not combine preventive measures, improving the screening and the access to care, it will be, of course, impossible to achieve elimination given the burnout, more new infection than diagnosed infection, and less cure than new infection in some countries related either to the behavior of some high-risk groups or to the absence of blood safety and nosocomial transmission. So just to conclude, HIV elimination is feasible and tools are there. This public health challenge needs education of patients, of physicians, of course of payers, because we have now the evidence that we are cost effective and that there is a benefit associated with HCV cure. Of course, one of the solutions, but it's not enough, is to achieve SVR by subpopulation with addition of microelimination, which will help in macroelimination. And just to finish, I think that we have better to consider individualization of the pathway from diagnosis to treatment than, as we heard, simplification of screening and treatment policies. Really, I think it's very adjusted to any situation. Thank you very much for your attention.